I'm excited to be here. Everybody else excited?
Yes.
Good. I'd like to start with a word of prayer for those who can, who are able, if you would kneel with me, and pray for me as well. Father, I come before you asking your blessing, asking that you will forgive me of my sins, that I may not be heard, but that you will be heard. Lord, I pray that you will touch my lips with a coal from off your altar, that I may speak your words, and not just your words only, but that I may speak your tone of voice and your body language as well, that I may convey this message accurately and adequately. Father, I ask your blessing, and I thank you for the promise that Christ said, where two or three are gathered together, that he is here in our very midst. So I thank you for that. This I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
When Pastor Allen told me the theme, preparation for the end, I got excited. I love that theme. That's my favorite theme. And I'm thinking, well, boy, you know, I want to talk about this, and I want to talk about that, and I want to talk about this, but I've only got three slots. He didn't give me enough time. And, you know, I said, Lord, there's probably going to be a lot of talk about spiritual preparation, and we all need that spiritual preparation. But I said, Lord, I want to talk about country living. I want to talk about physical preparation.
Good.
And I heard the loud cry. And I said, okay, Lord. No, I want to talk about the 144,000.
Yes.
And I heard the loud cry. I said, but Lord, I want to give a message of peace and safety. I don't want to cry aloud. I want to be able to give a message of peace and safety. And pondering that with a little bit of frustration, the thought that popped into my mind that was very clear to me was the three angels' messages are a message of peace and safety, if they're heeded.
Amen.
Revelation 18 says, come out of her, my people, that you be not partakers of her plagues. Friends, there is no peace and safety in receiving of those plagues.
Right.
And how will people know unless somebody tells them? We all want a message of peace and safety. But the best peace and safety is to give the warnings that God has called us to give. That is where there is peace and safety, in giving that warning and heeding that warning. So, this is overall entitled The Loud Cry. It's a series that I've been putting together that's not complete. And it is a message of peace and safety, if we heed it. But friends, as I go through this, all too often what we hear and what we see when we go through the three angels' messages is the first thing we want to do is we want to start pointing at everybody else. And that's not what I want to do today. As I go through these three angels' messages, I want each and every one of us to ask ourselves, am I a part of this in any way, shape, or form? Not point fingers, but ask, am I a part of this? Let's bring this home to ourselves. Do I support this system in any way, shape, or form? And I got to thinking about the three angels' messages, and you know what dawned on me that was very interesting, this really opened my eyes, is the fact that the three angels' messages lay out a series of steps of backsliding. The first angel gives the everlasting gospel. This is the everlasting gospel that is to go to the whole world. And this first angel is the cure to the problems of the second and third angel. Does that make sense?
Yes.
The first angel is the cure. And if we, for some reason, neglect or get something wrong in that first angel, then the second angel warns of the backslide that is about to happen. And if we go into the second angel and do not come back to the first angel's message, then the third angel is where we backslide into. So as we go through these messages, kind of think of them that way. They are showing progressive steps of backsliding. And so the message is a warning, warning us, if we find ourselves in one of these backslidden states, to turn back to the everlasting gospel. That is the message of the three angels' messages. It is a warning, and it is a message of peace and safety. And so, there's actually four angels? We only talk about three, but there are actually four angels. And I've got three time slots, so I have to drop one. And after, I don't want to have to do what I did last time, and that's cram two of them together. That was just, I think that was just too much. But, so I decided to drop the first angel. I think most of us here probably understand fairly the first angel's message. But I want to give a brief overview of the first angel. And it says, fear God, reverence God, and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment is come, and worship Him. We need to remember that there is a command to worship God in the first angel. Worship Him that made the heavens, the seas, and the fountains of waters. So the question really boils down to, who is God? We need to know who God is in that first angel. Because if we don't know who God is, then we can't be assured that we're worshiping Him. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So is God, is this the Father, the Son, the Spirit, or is it a triunity of all three? Because remember, if this is a triunity of all three, then we are to worship all three. And that presents a problem, does it not?
Mm-hmm.
So we need to know who God is. And if we don't get that right, then we backslide into the second angel's message. And that's where I want to pick this up, is the second angel's message. In Revelation chapter 14 and verse 8, you're more than welcome to open there and go with me. I'm going to have to go fairly quick, even though this is only the second angel this time. I'm still going to have to go fairly quick to try to cover this. So forgive me if I don't always wait till the pages are stopped turning. Revelation chapter 14 and verse 8, it says, and there followed another angel saying, Babylon is fallen. That great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. We like to think about Babylon in the second angel's message, and we like to start pointing fingers. We want to start pointing fingers at everyone else but ourselves. And so, as we go through this message, I want each and every one of us to ask, am I a part of this system in any way? Am I? Let's not use this to point fingers, but to ask myself, am I? All too often, friends, we like to get these messages and we like to tell people, you are a part of fallen Babylon. And when they say, well, you know, I really don't want to hear it, you say, no. You need to sit down and open up wide, because I'm going to fold up this Bible and I'm going to jam it down your throat. Don't we have that tendency? I'm as guilty, if not more so, than probably anybody else. When we see something new, we want to spread it, right? And when they don't want to hear, we push. We really want to spread it. But the question, who is Babylon? All too often, I think we get that confused. We think of Revelation 17 and we say, this has to do with the Catholic system, Babylon. We try to separate Babylon and the second angel as far from us as possible by aiming it at the Roman Catholic Church. But friends, there are some very subtle clues, some very simple clues that we tend to overlook sometimes. The second angel comes after the first angel, right? That's why it's called the second angel. I mean, that might seem pretty obvious, but sometimes we bypass that. So the second angel comes after the first. And if we look at the first angel, we can anchor the first angel solidly in time. It says the hour of his judgment, what?
Is come,
right? The hour of his judgment is come. When did that happen?
1844.
1844. So the proclamation of the first angel started a bit before 1844, but we can solidly anchor the first angel in the time frame of around October 22nd, 1844. So therefore, the second angel's message must come after October 22nd, 1844. Does that make sense? Has not the Roman Catholic system been in a fallen state for many centuries by this time?
Yes.
So it can't just apply to them. It must be broader than just that. If we look at Great Controversy, page 383, we find another not so subtle clue. It's kind of open. The message of Revelation 14 announcing the fall of Babylon, this is referring to the second angel's message, must apply, now pay special attention to this, must apply to religious bodies that were once pure and have become corrupt. Religious bodies that were once pure and have become corrupt. This is speaking of theological corruption. Friends, there's a lot going on out there that is plain, outright wrong corruption. Where tithe money goes, for example, I can't agree with that. But that's not what this is talking about. This is talking about theological corruption. Since this message follows the warning of the judgment, it must be given in the last days. The what days?
Last days.
What days are we living in?
Last days.
So do you think we need to pay special attention to this message?
Yes.
Absolutely. This message must be given in the last days. Therefore, it cannot refer to the Roman Church alone, for that church has been in a fallen condition for many centuries. So what then does Babylon mean? It means, literally, it means confusion, right?
Yeah.
Specifically by mixing truth with error, right? So we're talking theological again. Mixing of truth with error, and it becomes confusing. This is Babylon. But if we look at Revelation 17, we can find some more clues in Revelation 17. Now, I believe Revelation 17 is primarily focused at the Roman Church. But we can find some clues in Revelation 17 that helps us to further understand the second angel's message. Revelation 17, we're going to jump to verse 5. And upon her forehead was a name written. Name symbolizes what? Character, right?
Yes.
So this is a part of her very character. It is so ingrained. It has become a part of her very character. Mystery. What is the subject? It's theological, right? So there is a theological mystery involved with her. Babylon the Great, or in other words, great confusion. This is a confusion that is so great that it has become a mystery. The mother of harlots. Can you be a mother if you don't have children? No, you can't be called a mother unless you have children. So obviously she has children. And being that this is speaking in the sense of churches, she must have daughters. Does that make sense? And they're her daughters because they hold the same confusing theology. Can you see that there? So they hold the same confusing theology, and they are harlots. So the question then rises, well, what is a harlot? Well, the Bible often mixes the word harlot with, or harlotry with whoredom. I just don't like the second word. I don't like the first, but I really don't like the second. But it's the same thing. So if we look in Exodus chapter 34, we're going to look through verses 12 to 16, and we're going to see a definition for what harlotry or whoredom here is. And this is important to understand. Take heed to yourself. Who is being spoken of here? But it's literal Israel, right? But I believe the prophets spoke more for our times than they did for their own. So when I read these things, when I go through the Bible, I like to ask, how does this apply to me? And how does this apply to today? So I want to apply these couple of verses to today. So who is Israel today?
Us.
It is spiritual Israel now, right? Spiritual Israel. So take heed to yourselves, Seventh-day Adventists. Take heed lest you make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land, or in other words, other religions. Can you see that there? Other religions? So, whither thou goest, lest it be for a snare in the midst of thee. So making a covenant with other religions becomes a snare. And God goes on to tell us why. Verse 14, but you shall destroy their altars, break their images, and cut down their groves. In other words, do not worship their gods. For thou shalt worship no other god. For the Lord, whose name is Jealous, is a jealous God. Lest thou make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land, and they go a-whoring after their gods, and do sacrifice unto their gods, and one call thee, and thou eat of his sacrifice. And thou take of their daughters unto thy sons, and their daughters go a-whoring after their gods, and make thy sons go a-whoring after their gods. So what is whoredom, or harlotry? The worship of false gods here, right? So mystery is a deep theological mystery that can't be understood to the point that it's become a great confusion of truth and error. And she is a mother, and she has harlots. And these harlots are worshiping, they're going after false gods. Can you see that? I want to drive this closer to home. Testimonies, Volume 5, page 173 and 174. No outward shrines may be visible. There may be no image for the eye to rest upon. Yet we may be practicing idolatry. It is as easy to make an idol of cherished ideas or objects as to fashion gods of wood or stone. Pay special attention to this next one. Thousands have a false concept of God and His attributes. Having a false concept of God and His attributes is idolatry. Can you see that there? They are as verily serving a false God as were the servants of Baal. That's a strong statement. That's a very strong statement. Are we worshiping the true God as He's revealed in His Word, in Christ, in nature, or are we adoring some philosophical idol enshrined in His place? So friends, what I want to re-emphasize before I go on is announcing the fall of Babylon must apply to religious bodies that were once pure and have become corrupt. And having a false concept of God and His attributes is the same as Baal worship. Strong words, but that's what it says. So with that thought process, since we've gone over what that is, I want to look at a prophecy that's been given. And this prophecy is very powerful. I'm trying to stay behind the cameras. I keep starting to wander and catching myself, and I'm trying to stay behind the cameras.
I can follow you if you want to move around.
Okay, I might work your arm to death, so I will try to stay here. But I want to look at a prophecy called the Omega and the Alpha. This is a prophecy that deals with what we've just talked about, having a false concept of God and His attributes. And it's a prophecy telling us about a backsliding. Do you think a deadly heresy is a backsliding? That's definitely a backsliding. It's not just any backsliding. It's a deadly backsliding. This is a major issue. But before we can understand the Omega, we really need to understand the Alpha. Does that make sense? So we have to really dive into what the Alpha is. And so that's what we're going to do. And then we're going to... I think by the time we're done with the Alpha, it's going to be pretty clear what the Omega is. But then we're going to touch a little more on the Omega. I want to start reading First Selected Messages, page 202, third paragraph. And most of this information can be found here in First Selected Messages. And this is talking, I'm gonna kind of jump to the end of this paragraph, starting with, from the light given me by the Lord. From the light given me by the Lord, I knew that some of the sentiments advocated in this book, what book is she talking about? The Living Temple. Some of the sentiments advocated in this book did not bear the endorsement of God, and that they were a snare that the enemy had prepared for the last days. Remember hearing that a few minutes ago? So do we think that this is all past and done? No, it's for the last days. We are Seventh-day Adventists, right? We believe we're living in the last days. I thought that this would surely be discerned. You see, what happened is she believed that people would say, whoa, look at this. No, I don't think so. But is that what happened? No, people were like, wow, look at this. This is some good stuff. And she thought that it would be discerned. But friends, the Alpha nor the Omega are easily discerned by the majority. Page 203, paragraph 1. In the controversy that arose among our brethren regarding the teachings of this book, those in favor of giving it a wide circulation declared it contains the very sentiments that Sister White has been teaching. So do you think, this is talking about the Alpha. Friends, do you think the Omega is going to be any different? No. Do you think the Omega people or system is going to stand up and say, you know what, Sister White was inspiring, but not inspired? Or do you think they're going to say, look at what Sister White said. She's inspired, and she's telling us to do this. They're going to use her writings, right? They're going to take her writings, just as Kellogg did, and put them out there and say, look at what she said. This is proving my theology. Does that make sense? So it contains the very sentiments that Sister White has been teaching, is what they said. This assertion struck right to my heart. I felt heartbroken, for I knew that this representation of the matter was not true. Here Ellen White clearly denies that teachings from the Living Temple could be sustained from her writings. So it is with the Omega. They cannot be sustained from her writings. So Willie White, her son, comes to her and says, look, Mother, you need to at least read some of the book. And so in First Selected Messages 203, paragraph 2, we pick up where she says, as we read, I recognized the very sentiments against which I had been bidden to speak in warning during the early days of my public ministry, my public labors. When I first left the state of Maine, it was to go through Vermont and Massachusetts to bear a testimony against these sentiments. So I want to stop there. It's apparent that the ideas she found in Living Temple were ideas that she had been bidden to speak against earlier in her ministry. These were not new ideas to be introduced to the Advent movement. In fact, we're going to see that these ideas were already a part of most other religions. This wasn't something new. I want to pick up again in Selected Messages. Living Temple contains the Alpha of these theories, and I knew that the Omega would follow in a little while, and I trembled for our people. I knew that I must warn our brethren and sisters not to enter into controversy over the presence and personality of God. The statements made in Living Temple in regard to this point are incorrect. The scripture used to substantiate the doctrine there set forth is scripture misapplied, scripture twisted. I want you to notice there's some very subtle clues there. That she says there that Living Temple contains the Alpha of these theories, and that the Omega would follow, not might or could. She says it would follow. A lot of people today want to say, well, it didn't actually follow. It could have, but we managed to subvert it. But that's not the case. She said it would follow. The question is, what kind of theory is she talking about? She answers that question in the last part of her quote when she says that I must warn our brethren and sisters not to enter into controversy over the presence and personality of God. The Alpha and Omega obviously must deal with the very presence and personality of God. Remember, a false concept of God and His attributes is the same as Baal worship. It is the same as harlotry. So I want to give a quick summary so far. There's a lot of information, so I want to keep giving summaries. Sister White says that a false concept of the presence and personality of God, remember, that is it's the same as the false concept of God and His attributes, which is idolatry or harlotry, which is what the second angel's message is talking about. She says it is going to come. The question is not, will this lead a group of Seventh-day Adventists? Who is she writing to? Seventh-day Adventists, right? So the question is not, will this lead a group of Seventh-day Adventists to be included in the second angel? But when will this lead a group of Seventh-day Adventists to be included in this second angel's message? I'll let that sink in for a moment. It's strong, and it's hard to think about, but it's something that we need to look at. I want to keep reading and select it. First selected message is 204, paragraph 1. In a vision of the night, I was shown distinctly that these sentiments have been looked upon by some as the grand truths that are to be brought in and made prominent at the present time. I was shown a platform braced by solid timbers. The truths of the Word of God. Someone in high in responsibility in the medical work, this is Kellogg, was directing this man and that man to loosen the timber supporting this platform. Then I heard a voice saying, where are the watchmen that ought to be standing on the walls of Zion? Are they asleep? This foundation was built by the master worker and will stand storm and tempest. Will they permit this man to present doctrines that deny the past experience of the people of God? The time has come to take decided action. So we see here clearly that Kellogg's theology was attacking specific doctrines that the Advent movement that God raised up held. Can you see that? So it is a direct attack against theology that God gave to the Advent movement. It's important to note here that Kellogg was attacking the doctrine of the Godhead. If we've done any look at Kellogg and the book The Living Temple, we know that it was pantheistic, right? Pantheism is an attack on what theology? The Godhead, right? So Kellogg is attacking the Godhead in the Alpha. Do you think the Omega is going to be any different? No, it won't be any different. So he's attacking the Godhead found in the fundamental principles that the pioneers had been guided to by the Spirit of God. In Special Testimonies Series B, number 7, page 39, she has this to say. This is important to understand. But in his recent writings, his tendencies toward pantheism have been revealed. This was written in 1904. I want you to remember that. This time is important to understand. This was written in 1904. Can you remember that date? 1904. You see, friends, Kellogg did have pantheism seeping out of his book. But please notice that in some letters that I'm about to quote that were written not long after the book Living Temple, he shifted his theology slightly. Not much, but slightly. With this in mind, I would like to quote a couple of letters. The first one is a letter from A.G. Daniels to Elder Willie White. This is Ellen White's son. So Daniels writes to him concerning a conversation he had with Kellogg. So Daniel says that Kellogg then stated that his former views regarding the Trinity, he was non-Trinitarian originally, regarding the Trinity had stood in his way of making a clear and absolutely correct statement, but that within a short time he had come to believe in the Trinity and could now see pretty clearly where all the difficulty was, and believed he could clear up the matter satisfactorily. He told me that he now believed in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. And his view was that it was God the Holy Ghost and not God the Father that filled all space and every living thing. You know, friends, I've seen a lot on the Omega. There's new videos now about the Omega being contemplative prayer. I even heard one pastor say the Omega was music. I even heard one say it was jewelry. What do those have to do with the Alpha? Nothing. Nothing whatsoever. So how could that be? That would make no sense. Kellogg states clearly what the problem is in his theology. And what is that problem dealing with? The Godhead. And we are told that the Omega and the Alpha deal with the very presence and personality of God. But you might say, but he became Trinitarian, and this letter was written in 1903. What date did I ask you to remember a few minutes ago?
04.
So Kellogg here by 1903 believes in a Trinity, and in 1904, Ellen White says that in his recent writings, he has tendencies toward pantheism. She didn't say he had pantheism, but tendencies toward pantheism in his recent writings. What theology do you think she's talking about? His new theology. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, or God the Holy Ghost, as he says. So, what is pantheism then? I mean, most of the time when you ask somebody what is pantheism, they will say, well, it's God in everything. Right? Isn't that? Or it's Christ in everything. But does not Colossians 1:27 say, Christ in me, the hope of glory? Is that pantheistic?
No.
Why is that not pantheistic?
Through the Spirit.
It's because it's through the Spirit. Right? Jesus said, the Father in me and I in you. Is that pantheistic?
No.
Why? What is the difference? It's the view of God. Pantheism is not believing that God is in everything, because the Bible says that he is in me. Pantheism is believing that it's the being of God in everything.
Yes.
Does that make sense? So when we say it's God in everything, that's a half-truth. It's the being of God that is in everything. So I want to keep reading some letters that now these are from Kellogg. This is a letter from Elder G.I. Butler to Elder G.I. Butler from Kellogg. And he says this: as far as I can fathom the difficulty which is found in the living temple, the whole thing may be simmered down to this question: is the Holy Ghost a person? Is that a good question or what? That is a very, very good question. That is a question that most of us seem to grapple with, right? That's a good question. And Kellogg was no fool. He was very, very intelligent. So he knew what the difficulty was. And it boiled down to the question of, is the Holy Ghost a person? He goes on, writing to Elder G.I. Butler, he says, you say no. I had supposed the Bible said this for the reason that the personal pronoun he is used in speaking of the Holy Ghost. Heard that one before?
Yes.
Sister White used the pronoun he and has said in so many words that the Holy Ghost is the third person of the Godhead. Heard that one before?
Mm-hmm.
So he's using Sister White's writings to support his Trinitarian theology. Can you see that there? How the Holy Ghost can be the third person and not be a person at all is difficult for me to see. It's a good question, isn't it? That's a very good point. So the issue at hand is this. Is the Holy Ghost a person? As in God the Holy Spirit, according to Kellogg. That is how he is defining person. Because he said, I believe in God the Holy Spirit. So he is defining person as in God the Holy Spirit. Or is he the non-bodily personal presence of God himself? Remember, this is dealing with the presence and personality of God. It's obvious that Kellogg originally thought he could sustain his God the Holy Spirit sentiments from Sister White's writings and was confused and upset when he was told he could not. Could you see in his writings there that he was confused and upset? Could you see that? He'd obviously been told that he couldn't do that. And he was confused. This next one is First Selected Messages 203, paragraph 3. Sister White says, I am compelled to speak in denial of the claim that the teachings of Living Temple can be sustained by statements from my writings. There may be in this book expressions and sentiments that are in harmony with my writings, and there may be in my writings many statements which, taken from their connection and interpreted according to the mind of the writer of Living Temple, would seem to be in harmony with the teachings of this book. This may give apparent support to the assertion that the sentiments in Living Temple are in harmony with my writings. But God forbid that this sentiment should prevail. Can you see she's clearly denying that his theology could be found from her writings? But you might be saying, wait a minute, but that's dealing with the pantheism, not the Trinity. Some people have thought that this is dealing with pantheism and that she really didn't know that he changed his theology. But I want to read a quote. First Selected Messages, page 199, paragraph 3. It will be said that Living Temple has been revised. But the Lord has shown me that the writer has not changed. Did the writer just not say that he changed his theology? He went from non-Trinitarian pantheism to Trinity. Did he not say he just changed? But God said, no, there is no change. He might think there's a change, but it's no difference. There is no change. And she goes on with some very strong statements. And that there can be no unity between him and the ministers of the gospel while he continues to cherish his present sentiments. This is important to understand. There can be no unity. No unity. I am bidden to lift my voice in warning to our people, saying, be not deceived. God is not mocked. These are very strong words. I'm glad she said them and not me. I don't know that I would have what it takes to say that. That is very strong. So clearly, God revealed to her that he changed his theology, or that he said he was changing. Does that make sense? So you can't... Do you think God, this is dealing with the Alpha and the Omega, do you think God is not going to reveal something like this to her? To us, through her? Of course he's going to reveal that. That's an important thing. That's a major change. But I have a question, friends. If Kellogg was right about the Trinity, why did she continue to speak out against him? If Sister White tried to bring in a Trinity in 1898 with the writing of the Desire of Ages, this is 1903, 1904, if she tried to bring in a Trinity in 1898 with the Desire of Ages, why is she speaking out against him now? What does that make her to be? It makes her to be a false prophet. How dare she speak out against somebody who is trying to present truth. But was he presenting truth?
No.
Obviously not. She had some very strong words for him and for us today. A letter from Kellogg to G.I. Butler. This one is written February 21 in 1904, and it further clarifies Kellogg's understanding of the Holy Spirit. I tell you what, Kellogg understood this problem, and he stated it very clearly, very succinctly. I believe the Spirit of God to be a personality. You don't. But this is purely a question of definition. Is the Holy Spirit a person? The answer to that question is, how do you define person? How did Sister White define person? And how did Kellogg define person? I believe the Spirit of God is a personality. You say, no, it's not a personality. Now, the only reason why we differ is because we differ in our ideas as to what a personality is. Yet again, Kellogg hits it on the head. Your idea of personality is perhaps that of the semblance of a person or human being. Okay, what's the semblance of a person or human? A good example is Daniel chapter 2 and verse 1. Nebuchadnezzar dreamed a dream wherewith his, what was troubled?
Spirit.
His spirit was troubled, right? And his sleep broke from him. Who was troubled?
Nebuchadnezzar.
Are you sure it was Nebuchadnezzar?
Yes.
Why do we know that it was Nebuchadnezzar? Because we understand the state of the dead, right? We know that there is no such thing as what's theologically termed dualism. That I am two parts. I have a physical body and a living, separate spirit entity. We understand that. So when we read Daniel chapter 2 and verse 1, we understand that it's Daniel, or that it was Nebuchadnezzar that was troubled. The semblance of a person is just that. It was Nebuchadnezzar's spirit that was troubled. The spirit of Nebuchadnezzar is the semblance of a person. But if I were to go and say, Nebuchadnezzar, the spirit was troubled, you'd say, well, wait a minute now, brother. You're preaching spiritualism, right? Wouldn't that be spiritualism? Completely, totally. Do you see the difference? The spirit of Nebuchadnezzar versus Nebuchadnezzar, the spirit. There's a very, very big difference. I want to continue carrying that thought process forward and drive this further home. If my wife and I have been married for 15 years, and thank you. And it has been the best decision of my life was to do that. But we have been married for 15 years. We have been intimately connected. Husband and wife have become one. And I can say that we have become one. And if something were to happen to her and she were to die, I could say, biblically, her spirit lives on with me, right? Because I have her character up here. I understand, I know her character. So I can say her spirit lives on with me. But if I were to say, so I could say, Christy's spirit lives on with me. But if I were to say, Christy, the spirit lives on with me, that would be a major theological problem, right? You see the difference? There's a big difference. One is the semblance of a person. The other one is an independent person. One is the person themselves, and the other one is a totally different entity that lives within. A totally different intelligence, if you will. The spirit of Nebuchadnezzar versus Nebuchadnezzar the spirit. The spirit of Christy versus Christy the spirit. The spirit of God versus God the spirit. Can you see the difference now between those two statements? They are a world apart. They're two totally different things, and we shouldn't get confused by them. We hear that a lot, God the spirit. And we've heard it so much that we oftentimes don't think much of it. But friends, that's a totally different thing. That is a whole nother entity, a whole nother intelligence, not the semblance of a person. So I want to summarize again. Ellen White denies that her spirit-led views of the Godhead in any way harmonize with Kellogg's Trinitarian views of the Godhead. Have you seen that so far? Kellogg recognizes that his definition of the Holy Spirit's personhood is different than that of Adventist leadership's definition, particularly that of Ellen White. Kellogg's heresy was the Alpha and the Omega would come soon. Not might or could, but would come soon. The Omega of heresy is a false concept of God, and if it is accepted by a group of Seventh-day Adventists, it would constitute their fall into harlotry. Very strong words again. I want to keep reading. First Selected Messages 204, last paragraph of 204. The enemy of souls has sought to bring in the supposition that a great reformation was to take place. So now we have jumped from talking about the alpha of deadly heresies. Has that been pretty clear what the alpha is? Has that been pretty clear so far? Do we need to get up and do some jumping jacks? So now we're going to transition into the Omega. This is where she starts talking about the Omega of deadly heresies. So the enemy of souls has sought to bring in the supposition that a great reformation was to take place among the Protestants, among Baptists and Presbyterians. Seventh-day Adventists. This message is hitting home. We can't point fingers now, can we? They have to be turned inward. And we have to ask ourselves, am I a part of this in any way? Not beat somebody over the head with these messages. That doesn't do any good. We might have the truth, but if we're beating them over the head, it doesn't do any good. Just as Brother Thomas was presenting earlier. A great reformation was to take place among Seventh-day Adventists, that this reformation would consist in giving up the doctrines, the fundamental principles, the very doctrines which stand as the pillars of our faith, and engaging in a process of reorganization. So friends, when you give up the fundamental principles, you've reorganized. You're no longer the same religion. You see that? Mm-hmm. Were this reformation to take place, what would result? The principles of truth that God in His wisdom, not error, in His wisdom has given the remnant church would be discarded. Our religion would be changed. Friends, if you're not standing on the fundamental principles, if you're standing on Kellogg's theology, you're really not a Seventh-day Adventist according to what she just said. You hear that? That comes down to the definition of what is a Seventh-day Adventist. Our religion would be changed. The fundamental principles, and don't get those mistaken with the fundamental beliefs. They're different. Don't mistake that. That have sustained the work for the last 50 years would be accounted as error. A new organization would be established. Books of a new order would be written. A system of intellectual philosophy would be introduced. The founders of this system would go into the cities and do a wonderful work. The Sabbath, of course, would be lightly regarded as also the God who created it. Nothing would be allowed to stand in the way of the new movement. And believe me, nothing is allowed to stand in the way. You try to stand in the way and see what happens. Nothing is allowed. The leaders would teach that virtue is better than vice, but God being removed, why is God removed? Because they're not worshiping the true God of the Bible. So God is removed. No matter how much they call Him God, God is removed. No matter how much the children of Israel danced around that golden calf and called it Jehovah, it was not Jehovah. No matter how much they called it Jehovah, it was not. They would place their dependence on human power, which without God is worthless. There's no righteousness by faith. Their foundation would be built on sand, and storm and tempest would sweep away the structure. I want you to notice that she's not talking about a great reformation in the Catholic religion or the Pentecostal churches. She's talking about the omega of apostasy in the Seventh-day Adventist church. She says that in this reformation there would be doctrines thrown out. The principles of truth that God has given in His wisdom to the remnant church would be discarded and our religion would be changed. Friends, do we fancy the idea that we're living in the last days? Is not that the theme of this camp meeting? Then we must realize that the prophecy of the Omega must have already come. If we're living in the last days, then the Omega must already be here. It can't be future, because we're in the last days. So it must be here now. Let us ask ourselves these questions. One, are there any doctrinal changes that have taken place concerning the presence and personality of God? Does this change in fundamental principles change our religion? Would the old principle belief be accounted as error? Yes, yes, and yes to all three questions. Ellen White predicted that there would be books of a new order written. Froome wrote this in his book, Movement of Destiny. How appropriate. It was prophesied. What he did was prophesied. Movement of Destiny. May I here make a frank personal confession? That has got to get your ears standing up, right? Anytime somebody says, may I make a frank personal confession, you're like, ooh, this is going to be dirty, right? This is going to be good. Not something you want to the world. So may I make a frank personal confession. I was compelled to search out a score of valuable books written by men outside our faith. What he just said was politically correct. I want to reread it biblically correct. I was compelled to search out a score of valuable books written by the Daughters of Babylon. Is not that biblically correct?
Yes.
Why? Why did he have to do this? Because, he says, there were no previous pathfinding books on the question, God the Holy Spirit in our literature. Friends, the pioneers wrote over and over and over and over again about the Holy Spirit, did they not? But they never said anything about God the Holy Spirit. At least not that Froome liked, let's put it that way. They spoke abundantly of that as well, but not in a positive light that he liked. But you know what, friends? That includes the spirit of prophecy as well. He couldn't seem to manage to come up with enough information from her to sustain this theology. So he had to go to the Daughters of Babylon to get it. Bear with me, I'm getting close. There were obviously no books of this order until Froome started a new order of books such as Movement of Destiny, The Coming of the Comforter, Questions and Answers on Doctrine. Many people out there in independent ministries, when you say that, their ears prick up. But they don't know, understand what all it entails. They want to focus on things like the dual atonement's been done away with. And should we? Absolutely. That's an important thing. They want to focus on the nature of Christ and these other things, and they are important, but not to the neglect of the main reason Questions and Answers on Doctrine was written.
Kingpin.
The kingpin, yes. And since then, there has been a flood of books of a new order. In fact, I want to quote this. Next quote is taken from Adventist.org. This is fundamental two? Yes, I think it's fundamental number two. It's been a while since I've read it. And they say there is one God. How many gods?
One
God, and they give a definition. This is what the colon is. The colon says that what follows is a definition for what was just stated. So there is one God, and the definition of that one God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. a unity of three co-eternal persons. So with that definition, every place that God comes up, we can implant God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, because that is the definition. Does that make sense? So I'm going to implant that as we go along. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit is immortal, all-powerful, all-knowing, above all, and ever-present. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit is infinite and beyond human comprehension, yet known through his/their self-revelation. God the Father, this is where it gets important. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit is forever worthy of worship and adoration and service by the whole creation. That is dangerous theology.
Amen.
That is very, very dangerous theology. Friends, as the pastor was talking last night, he says, if we're looking for Jesus over here when he's over here, that's not going to do us any good, is it? If we're looking over here. And that's exactly what the devil wants. Paul warned us about another Jesus, did he not? The devil's got us looking to another Jesus over here when the real Jesus is over here. We are looking for, many people are looking for the Spirit to fall in the latter rain over here, God the Holy Spirit to fall in the latter rain when the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, is falling over here. Friends, if we're looking in the wrong direction, we're going to miss the true latter rain. We are in the end, and we want that true latter rain. In order to have that true latter rain, we have to understand the Father, Son, and Spirit. Otherwise, we're going to be looking in the wrong direction. This quote shows that the Holy Spirit has been deified as a third God. That's pretty clear. When in fact, it is the non-bodily personal presence of God Himself, not a third intelligence. This teaching does seriously change our religion. The following is a quote from George Knight, and most of us probably have heard this dozens of times, but I want to quote it again. And he's a church historian. He says this, "Most of the founders of Seventh-day Adventism," which from my search is actually all, except for Canright when he apostatized and took on the Trinity, and Kellogg when he took on the Trinity. Pretty much the rest of them, not just most. "Of the founders of Seventh-day Adventism would not be able to join the church today if they had to subscribe to the denomination's fundamental beliefs." Not principles, beliefs. "More specifically, most would not be able to agree to belief number 2, which deals with the doctrine of the Trinity. For Joseph Bates, the Trinity was an unscriptural doctrine. For James White, it was that old Trinitarian absurdity. And for M.E. Cornell, it was the fruit of the great apostasy." Do you think he knew what he was talking about? "Along with such doctrines as Sunday keeping and the immortality of the soul." This came from Ministry Magazine, October 1993, page 10. Friends, I would say that if our pioneers couldn't join the church today, do you think that means that religion's changed? Yeah. The question really is not could they join, the question is would they join? They would take one look at that and say, no. That's what they did in the past, didn't they? Why do you think they would change their mind today? They wouldn't. Do you think they didn't study this subject? Absolutely they studied it. They knew all about the Trinity. And, you know, a lot of people will say, well, they were rebutting the Trinity, but we have tritheism. You know, they actually spoke against tritheism as well? Not as much, because it wasn't as prevalent during their time, but they spoke against it. And besides that, the principles that apply to one apply to the other. If you really look at it and study it out, it doesn't matter. That's why the Catholic Church says, it doesn't matter. I don't care if you believe in tritheism. Come on and join. They don't care. First Selected Messages, page 205, paragraph 1. Who has authority to begin such a movement? We have our Bibles. We have our experience attested to by the miraculous working of the Holy Spirit. We have a truth that admits of no compromise. How much?
None.
No compromise. Shall we not repudiate everything that is not in harmony with this truth? I hesitated and delayed about the sending out of that which the Spirit of the Lord, not the Lord the Spirit, but the Spirit of the Lord impelled me to write. I did not want to be compelled to present the misleading influences of these sophistries, but in the providence of God, the errors that have been coming in must be met. They must be, no matter how much we dislike meeting them, no matter how much we dislike giving the loud cry and we want to give a message of peace and safety, we must still meet these errors. I want to read a quote, one more quote here. This is found in Signs of the Times, May 2006. May of 2006, page 60. We worship and love you, Heavenly Father, for who you are. And Jesus, we worship and adore you for becoming our brother. Is anything wrong so far? No. But the third sentence is a major problem. And Holy Spirit, we worship and love you too for making all this real to us. Oh, but I don't worship the Holy Spirit. The church doesn't worship the Holy Spirit. Friends, this is an official publication. This is their theology. This is official. And Holy Spirit, we worship and love you.
You too.
You too.
In addition.
In addition, yes. Manuscript 1, February 24, 1915. Ellen White died in 1915. I am charged to tell our people they do not realize that the devil has device after device, and he carries them out in ways they do not expect. Satan's agencies will invent ways to make sinners out of saints. I tell you now that when I am laid to rest, great changes will take place. What will take place?
Great changes.
Great changes. When will they take place? When she's laid to rest. Do you think the Omega has yet to come? She's been laid to rest for 100 years now. We can't keep putting off the Omega into the future. It's already here. This is a very interesting, Judges 8:33. This is very, very interesting to what I just quoted. And it came to pass as soon as Gideon was dead that the children of Israel turned again and went a-whoring after Balaam and made Baal-Berith their god. When did they do this?
After
Gideon died. Could I not say, and it came to pass as soon as Sister White was dead that the spiritual Israel, Seventh-day Adventist, turned again and went a-whoring after Balaam?
Mm-hmm.
Can you see that parallel there? So, a summary. The Omega of heresy is a false concept of God, and it is accepted by a group of Seventh-day Adventists as prophesied by Ellen White, and this constitutes their fall from purity into harlotry. Thus the completion of the second angel's message. And there followed another angel saying, Babylon has fallen, that great city, because she made all nations. How many nations?
All
nations. Denama nations. Because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Friends, the second angel's message is complete. When we look at the third angel's message, we're going to see that that's almost complete. There's basically only one thing left in the third angel's message to be completed. Friends, I want to ask the question, not pointing fingers, does no good to point fingers. The purpose of this message is not so we can point fingers at someone else. The purpose of this message is so that we can ask ourselves, am I a part of this in any way, shape, or form? Do I support Babylon's meetings by showing up and lending credence to them? Do I support fallen Babylon by sending them God's tithe money? I think that one hits closer to home for many people. Do I do that? Can I support that message with God's money? Can I support the Omega of Deadly Heresy with God's money? Could I do that? I can't. I can't do that. So I want to ask you a question. Well, I'm going to go to 1 Kings 18:21. And Elijah came to all the people and said, how long halt ye between two opinions? If the Lord be God, follow him. But if Baal, then follow him. So I ask you this question. Will you follow the God of the Bible, the pioneers and the fundamental principles of the Philadelphian church? Will you do that? If you will do that, I would ask that you would kneel in prayer with me. Father, I thank you for your precious gift, the gift of your Son dying on that cross. And Father, I thank you that veils have been lifted and that we understand that Christ did die on that cross. And Lord, I thank you for the gift of your Spirit, that you will fill each and every one of us so fully with your Spirit, but that they don't see us, but they see Christ in us. And Lord, I thank you for this message of peace and safety. This is a message of peace and safety if we heed it. For if we do not heed it, Father, there is no safety in receiving of the plagues. And so I thank you for this message. And Lord, I pray for each and every one of us here that has made a decision to follow you. I pray that you will send angels mighty in strength to watch over and to keep each and every one of us. For Lord, the devil is not going to be happy that we have made the decision to follow you. And so I pray the protection and I pray the peace that surpasses all understanding to fall upon each and every one of us as we walk in your way. And this I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.